covered the job of heading the commercial and industrial hub of Kerala was his first assignment as a district collector. During the year-long training, he served as the assistant collector of Palakkad, followed by a 1.5-year-long stint as the Idukki sub-collector before taking over as director at KSITM. Sri Mohammad Y. Safirullah leaves behind a commendable work, body of work at KSITM. It was under him that a slew of initiatives was either rolled out or gathered traction. This include e-office, e-district, which puts various government services on fast track, e-procurement that helped bring about transparency in procurement, online transfer of registry, and cloud enablement at that state data center. His posting at KSITM was in time with his educational background and pre-civil service job profile. With Bachelor of Engineering, MBA, and ME in Public Policy against his name, Sri Mohammad Y. Safirullah had worked at Tata Consultancy Services for 2 years before joining IBM, where he spent 3 years. He served as District Collector of Ernakulam, Director of Kerala State IT Mission, etc. Currently, he is serving as Secretary of Finance, Resource and Electronics and Communication Technology Department. Now, without any further ado, I request Sri Mohammad Y. Safirullah to talk to us on the topic Startup Ecosystem in India. Also, I request everyone to kindly put their doubts and queries in the chat box.
Thank you, Ajit. Good morning, friends. Firstly, I'd like to thank Pramod and SMS Institute for the opportunity to share a few thoughts. Let me share my screen. I hope the screen is visible. Can you see? Yeah, okay, fine. So thanks for the opportunity. For the next 30 to 40 minutes, I thought I would briefly try to give an ecosystem view of how Indian startup ecosystem is there and how Kerala-specific startup ecosystem is there. So I'll try dividing this entire presentation into two halves. First, I will talk about the national perspective, where are we as a startup ecosystem, and from Kerala perspective, what are the schemes which I will be able to talk in depth, and if you have any queries, we'll be able to take it up further. So before we proceed, friends, as students of management, I feel it's an unique opportunity where we all are there. I remember I did in my management PGDM, I did from TFI Management Institute. This was from 2005 to 2007. So I find that all of you are in an exciting position right now. The country is moving in an exciting phase, not only in speed, but in various dimensions. COVID for the last 1.5 years since March 2020 has been creating an disruption of sorts. Though we have had a lot of challenges in the last couple of years, financial challenges as an economy, I feel that in the coming decade or so, there'll be tremendous opportunities. Because earlier digital transformation, when we say, it was a matter of choice for many companies, even for government. But now actually, citizens are no longer ready for the status quo. They want easy way of transaction. They want digital transformation to be norm. And in fact, at government, it's a huge challenging task because, you know, we have a legacy of, you know, a bureaucratic legacy, procedures, rules, and we find that as a challenge. But in private sector, if you see, it has gone at breakneck speed. Wherever companies are investing, you know, wherever they were planning to invest in 22, 23 or 23, 24, they're trying to prepone their investment. So what I wanted to tell the students at SCMS and all the management students is you are at an exciting time. You are entering your career. And the next 2-3 decades, you all would have exciting opportunities. But you should ensure that you have the fundamental skills which are necessary to thrive in this particular sector. So with this few words, I'll get into the my topic for the day. So as a country, if you see, friends, we are the third largest ecosystem in the world. And the largest in terms of, I'm talking on what is largest, let us define that in terms of the numbers, right? But if you look at the scale, actually, we have a long way to go, right? If you look at still the scale of a startup ecosystem, if you look like where the United States is, still, I find that we have a long way to go. But looking at the speed at which we are growing, it would be maybe 3-4 years will be maybe catch up with in terms of innovations on what leading technology countries are doing. If you look at our own country, in terms of 2019 ranking, I'm talking about when I say ranking, I'll be referring to Government of India ranking given by DPIIT. Gujarat in 2019 stood first. That is the top category. And the second category was shared between Karnataka and Kerala, which is the top performer category. Our state also, Kerala, has been as a leader in both ranking in 2019 and 2018. So if you look at these three states per se, Gujarat, Karnataka, and Kerala, they are there as top, either in best performer or top performer for the last 2 years. This year, 2020, the ranking is still awaited. This year's ranking for the previous year, that is 2020. Now, if you look at this per se, the map itself, you find that Gujarat obviously is doing pretty well, and we have Karnataka and Kerala are top performers. We have good performance in many states like Telangana. We have excellent performance Telangana, Andhra Pradesh also, Tamil Nadu. And we have a good performance even in Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand is picking up, and certain northeastern states also. In terms of number, let us understand the numbers. We have about 55,000 plus industries, that is the startups, which are recognized by DPIIT. Across 56 unique industries. One common misconception we have about startup is that we feel that startup is only in technology areas. It is technology driven, but across various industrial domains. If you look at IT services, yes, it is a primary industry where the startups are there, but we have in healthcare, life sciences, which is a big opportunity these days, education, professional and commercial services, and agriculture. You may have heard about AgTech term, agriculture technology. AgTech is a big emerging area. Particularly in the last 2 years, three sectors have had huge growth across the globe. One is healthcare. Because of COVID, people started, already healthcare is a huge expense, in terms of if you look at a country like India, we have about 4-5% of government expenditure on healthcare. And if you look at out-of-pocket expenses of citizens also, we have about 10 to 15% of the entire expense getting into healthcare, one form or the other. So that is a huge industry, which is again looking at a major digital transformation era. The second major industry which benefited because of the COVID crisis, I'm talking about an opportunity in a crisis, is educational technology, edutech that we call as. The new innovative ways of learning and a lot of this online kids learning programs, a lot of training programs, a lot of skilling programs are all in this particular domain. The third area which has grown and which is showing a lot of promise is agriculture. Because if you look at agriculture in a country like India, if you look at 2011 census, friends, we have about 50% of our population which is dependent on agriculture, either directly or indirectly. Though young population is moving towards new domain, we still have half of our country depending on agriculture. So unless we make substantial quality improvement in this sector, it will not be possible to make a positive difference in life of our citizens. So this is an area again where we are, as a country, we are trying to look at how do we increase productivity by putting agriculture at the front. And even a lot of countries like Australia, United States, and European countries are trying to look at agriculture as a major area. So top five startup industries are there. I would say the pick among these three, among these five are healthcare, education, and agriculture. Almost in all the districts in our country, we have at least one registered startup. The top six performers in terms of numbers are Maharashtra, Karnataka, Delhi, Uttar Pradesh, Gujarat, and Haryana. If you look at Delhi, Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, it is all, I'm talking about the national capital territory. And so we are talking about Gurgaon on this side in Haryana. We are talking about Noida on this side in UP and Delhi per se. So that's a big, I would say, technology area which is developing. Bangalore historically has been and is a leader in IT segment in our country. We have the Mumbai Pune area, which is developing and moving towards this particular domain. And Gujarat is a front runner. And in South, we have Kochi, which is becoming as a big startup hub. So we have about 6 lakh jobs which are being created. About the representation of women, about 46, we can say half of the startups have at least one women director. But in my view, if you look at the participation of women work in this particular domain, it is much lacking. Particularly the women director is more because of the corporate, ministry has brought in formal directions. But otherwise, in Kerala, if you look at it, is only if you look at the participation of the holders, it is only between 20% to 25%, and we have to address that gap and move forward. So first 800 odd days it took us as a country to reach 10,000 startup. Then it was only 180 days to set up the next 1,000, and now it is going at a huge speed. These are some of the facts. If you look at the unicorn landscape, you may be knowing about unicorn. Unicorn is unicorn is something unique, right? And in business parlance, we talk about whose valuation is at least $1 billion. So India right now, we have 63 unicorn, and out of the total numbers, in 2021, this financial year itself, we had about 26 unicorns, right? Which is about 30-40% of this particular number. So in 2021, I believe we would almost reach 50, that is a general expectation. Let us see how things work out in the next 3 months. And this speed also has been increasing. And if you look at the top cities the unicorn prefer, it is a traditional cities where IT-centric population is located. Bangalore, Gurgaon, Mumbai, and Noida. The reason is, if you look at, these are very niche sectors, right? Niche startup per se. As a concept is when you are trying to address a specific problem because of an innovation, you try to address that particular issue in a better way. So therefore, you have a lot of technology dependency. So therefore, if you look at the areas where these unicorns are expanding, it is in the traditional IT areas. And the unicorns, in addition to the earlier areas, domains that I mentioned, if you look at the sectors per se, it is in fintech is coming up big way. E-commerce and supply chain logistics delivery, it's all the entire chain which has developed because of this COVID and related constraints on the physical movement. So therefore, e-commerce has really picked up. All of us have been using it in one way or the other. And in the last 2 years, people who are using it, we have tried to increase our dependence on e-commerce. Therefore, it creates opportunity in the supply chain management and the logistics per se. So these are the areas where things have developed. FinTech is going big time. For example, concepts like neobanking are coming up. We have our own neobank in Kerala, FinCorp, which is there. A lot of neobanks are there. Neobanks, friends, as you may know, is a bank which doesn't have a physical setup, tries to do entire thing online. Earlier, there was not much acceptance to neobank per se, but now it is either forced, and people are also looking at how many of us actually have gone to a bank in the last 5 years. I would say it has cut down tremendously because almost all the services are there online, except when you are taking a loan, where even now, unfortunately, some physical signatures or presence is required because those are high value transactions on registration. Otherwise, actually, most of the things you can get it done online itself. So this is how the unicorn landscape is turning up. In the first 6 months, I just gave a brief. Things are picking up. Bangalore, NCR, Delhi region. When I talk about this region, I'm talking about Gurgaon, Delhi, and Noida per se. These are the areas where a lot of things are happening. And I feel maybe the 40-50 unicorns, maybe we'll be able to do this year as a country. So the next few slides I have borrowed from Government of India Startup India site. So looking at the technical definition, what is a startup? Let us understand that before moving forward. In terms of legal structure, it's a private limited company or a limited liability or partnership or registered partnership. I will not get into that. You all may be learning it as part of corporate laws. So it is a registered entity, right? So that is what we want to know. It has to be registered. It cannot be an unregistered entity. Once it is registered, it have maximum 8 years where it can take the benefit of a startup is 10 years from the date of incorporation. From how it is registered in the respective startup ecosystems. For example, in Kerala, we have Kerala Startup Mission. And in terms of financial transactions, it should not have a revenue of 100 crore. It should be less than 100 crore for any of the financial years. The moment it exceeds 100 crores, then it loses its startup entity recognition. And this is a subjective thing, which the respective startups, missions or agencies look at. It should be an innovative solution. It should be scalable. Obviously, it should create the jobs and wealth as it proceeds. So once this innovation and scalability is very critical, if there is no innovation, and let us say you are technically just opening a shop, just a grocery shop, it is not a startup. It will not be recognized as a startup. But if you say, you are trying to look at, you are trying to look at blockchain and trying to ensure this origin, the place of origin is verified through a blockchain-enabled system, and therefore you get into the supply chain. That is something that you are working on. Then obviously it's an innovative solution to a problem which is there. So that is a critical element in a startup. So this is a rough structure. So first three is very clear about the legal entity, being it a legal entity, the 10 years concept and 100 year crores in as a revenue. The innovation is a generic, I would say, gray area, which is subjective in nature. If you want to get registered as a startup, it's very simple. Obviously you can upload the documents within 30 minutes, but then even if you have the supporting documents already, you can get it done in registered in 2 days. So things are that simple at Government of India level now. So why one should register as a startup? Why people want to get it? Basically, they have a huge opportunity to leverage on the funds and get a lot of other benefits. So what are they? Firstly, the public procurement norms are easier. For example, if you talk about Kerala as such, we have certain exemptions that startups can directly get into. The procurement era, we call government as a marketplace. So if some department wants to procure, they can directly get into a link with startup and procure up to 20 lakhs. So a lot of such facilities are there. So the tender route is short-circuited in those cases. Support for patent and IPR is given. Tax exemption is there. There is an exemption from our angel tax also. A lot of corpus is there, so they can get in touch with the venture capitalists, respective state governments have schemes, Government of India has schemes to SITCO and all. A lot of seed capital is there. Some of the facts, you can go through it, I'll share the PPT, so you need not worry about that. We are trying as a country to develop certain international markets, which is niche in nature. For example, these are the 11 international bridges we are trying to look at. Every country is trying to get in, friends, we should understand, every country is trying to get into a niche market. For example, if you look at Australia, I was trying to study that ecosystem. They're trying to get into defense and space in a big way. For example, the city of Adelaide is capital of the state of South Australia in Australia. So that state is trying to launch a satellite in the next couple of years. So that way, actually, it will be the first provincial government or state in the entire world to launch a satellite of its own. The idea is to focus on space and defense as a big sector. So therefore, the startups which are linked in defense or space, it becomes prudent to target Australia, South Australia specifically as a market. Similarly, if you look at fintech, we obviously have London, which is a financial capital, New York, which is there. So there are certain specific areas for certain specific domains. So that is what we are trying to look at. There are a lot of emerging areas also, for example, in Russia, in Japan, in Portugal, Sweden, in cybersecurity. Brazil is coming up big way in South America. So these are the areas where we are trying to look at as a country. I would now move on to Kerala Startup Mission. Now the question is, we know that we as a country are going in a big way in startups. So what are we as a state doing? So see, this is the, So this is the statistics, what we had tried to do. If you look at 2014-15, Kerala as a state was the first state to have a Kerala startup policy. So we are proud of that achievement. And then it started improving, and now it has really gone up big. So the building that you see, Integrated Startup Complex, in fact, you are, SCMS is also located in Kalamacheri. So this was inaugurated 2 weeks back, 2 or 3 weeks back, by Honorable Chief Minister. The largest software township, startup township in their country. And that area is also looking up big way. We have Rajiv Gandhi Biotech, which is looking at innovation in healthcare. We have the Maker Village, the largest hardware ecosystem, startup ecosystem in the country. That is an area that we are trying to develop as a center in our state. We have about 3,900 startups. This is now about 4,004 accelerators, incubators, mini incubators in association with colleges. We have about exposure to 2,000 crores fund, which the startups, if they found, they are found suitable by VCs and angel fundings, they can look into that. About 30,000 plus jobs have been done. 10 crore plus innovation grants. Innovation grants is when you have an idea, but you want to try out some product so that to actually see if it works or not. And we have a lot of aspiring entrepreneurs also. And we have fund of funds concept. Fund of fund concept is try to bring in venture capitalists and angel investors who are there in big cities like Mumbai or Bangalore, but who are hesitant to come. So we try to invest X rupees and they try to invest 2X rupees into our startup ecosystem. So we have about 13 plus years, I would say 2014 was a year when we actually started getting it big. We started looking at technology business incubator, which was started in Technopark. We got recognition for that from Department of Space Technologies in 2007. 2014 was when actually government of Kerala looked at, yes, this is something called startup. Otherwise, the startup word was not there. No, it came into this lexicon only less than 10 years back. Then we started to the startup policy in 2015. We got award in 2018-19, which I touched on. Now we have the India's largest startup hub and a lot of other recognitions. And what is the ecosystem which is there? Is that one is we have the government which is there. State and central government. Then we have the investors or venture capitalists. Investors or venture capitalists are also in the back, supported by research centers. Works ultimately, once and someone has to really get a fund, there's a lot of research which these people do to ensure that sufficient returns over and above what the market gives is actually possible in that particular startup. So there are a lot of research centers who work behind this investors and venture capitalists. We have industry partners, community society is obviously behind us. They keep giving us opinions, some positive criticisms. On the other side, we are having linkages with the colleges, a lot of colleges from where actually the innovation begins. We have technology incubators and innovation zones linking students, bringing in young entrepreneurs. We used to have this Young Entrepreneurship Summit in Kochi before 2018, but because of COVID last 2 years, obviously physical conferences are not there. We hope at least next year we'll be able to start it. We have this entire registration process is all online with a unique ID. It's a simple process just on the lines of government of India, the process which is there. So what we are trying to do, this is an interesting slide, which I would request you to pay a bit of attention. So what is this we are trying to do in the startup puzzle? Is the end-to-end thing. See, first one is we have to inspire people. Once inspiring is done, we have to educate them that what actually things are. After educating them, you have to look at, okay, fine, now you know stuff. You come and try out various things, right? And after they come up with various innovative ideas, you try to incentivize them and try to then move them to the next stage, which is a launch stage, maybe a limited launch. How do you see yourself going? Then try to grow it. And once you grow, then the impact actually, you try to push and get access to VCs, fund of funds, and try to get exposed. So what are we trying to do in the entire end-to-end spectrum? First one, inspire. So we have the innovation summits where we try to take ideas, brainstorm ideas, how they can solve public issues, government departments throw this challenge, hackathons and all this. We have Huddle Kerala, we have projects like Seeding Kerala, we have She Loves Tech to inspire girls to come into this particular area and try to explore how they can become entrepreneurs and problem solvers, not get into jobs. That is the first aspect that we are trying to get in, mostly in association with educational institutions, by conferences. Second, we try to educate them. Once we try and find out certain people, certain population, certain technocrats, certain managers are all trying to getting inspired, we try to filter them and try to get into the innovation cell. We have 280 such innovation cells. We organize special design summer schools. Summer is just a vacation schools, you can call it. We have the Fab Lab sort of academy. We have electronics at school. At school level, we try to develop this electronics programming. So we try to educate them in the basics of these things. Once this education is inculcated, a few of them actually get filtered out and come where they are ready to try out to the next level. Therefore, they have access to this Fab Labs, the Future Labs. We throw various idea challenges at them. What I said just now, this is the problem of water authority. How can you solve this? This is a problem of waste management. How can you solve? We have innovation zones, carefully curated ecosystem where they can explore and try to find out solutions. The next stage is once they try out something like a project or something, we expose them to the incubators where they can get and try to mold that solution into a product. We give them seed funds, supports, innovation grants, and also patents if a solution is unique, and R&D grants. Then obviously the growth stage where they have exposure, they need to get into the market and they need to raise funds, they have exposure to fund of funds and other VCs. So these are some of the photos we thought, like one is this, these are done before the COVID, so tech startup conference, the seaside huddle where we try to explore problems in an informal setting, the student innovator concepts, the IEDC summits which were conducted, Seeding Kerala investor network programs, where we try to bring in leading investors and VCs from across the globe and try to give their perspective to the audience, and our effort to ensure that equity is there. We have programs like She Loves Tech, where we try to develop the the ideas with specific importance on scaling up, how they can be associated with various stages. Yeah, some of the education aspects that we try to look at, summer schools is basically the, vacation schools, and Singularity India Global Impact Challenge was conducted, various IEDCs are there, and FabLab Academy conducts various programs. And we have FabLab Kerala Network also, which is developing big time, and we have a lot of facilities and R&D projects and trainings also, which are conducted. And future technology labs are coming up, where we try to focus on this areas. You may have seen NASSCOM's 10 next generation technologies, right? Like which includes blockchain, AR, VR, data analytics, and robotics, RPAs. So these are some of the 10 areas where we try to focus so that we try to become or create entrepreneurs in those areas. At the same time, arrange a mentoring programs also with them, because an idea may come and they may try to develop a product, but beyond a level, they need mentoring support. Financial support, in my view, is secondary. I would say more is about the mentoring projects where they need good guidance. We have the innovation zones, like for example, electricity board specifically has a lot of innovation zones. Water authority and police department also has this. About 20 challenges, probably 50 problem statements where their idea challenges were conducted, where we try to bring in the entire team towards how solutions can be done. Now the virtual incubation has increased in the last 2 years because of COVID, but other than that, we before 2019, the focus was more on the physical program. And I think in the future, it will be a hybrid of both physical and virtual. It cannot be physical alone because people are working from remote, and that is a reality all of us have to face, you know, have to face in the next few years. So it will be a mix of both physical and virtual incubation projects. And the incubators, we are ensuring that we have these incubator projects are there across the state in an even manner. We don't want any of the promising young people to get, miss out on the opportunities. We have specialized incubators, which is there. And one is a Maker Village. Maker Village is the largest hardware incubator in the country. We have BioNest near just near your institute in Kalamacheri, where the innovations linked to health industries is all linked. We have Mobile 10X, mobile-based initiative center in Kozhikode, where we try to focus on innovations led to startups, led to mobile technologies from there. And we have the space incubator in Trivandrum, which is picking up, I would say. And now the next point you may be interested in asking is, what is that we are doing to fund early stage? So we have innovation grants, which actually, when we find a disruptive idea, we try to give the grants. So about 300 plus right now, startups have got benefited from this. We have seed loans to give the next level support. We have patent support. So about 55 patents have been given. An R&D grant, which is subjective in nature. Scaling up support is also given. So scaling up is next level. So once you have a proven project, we have accelerators to help them execute pilot projects fast. That is just as the word says, accelerate. Marketing support is given. Global exposure is given. We send a lot of these startups to specific areas, a lot of this startup conferences abroad, and specific ecosystem we try to spend them instead of just generic melas or something. We have fund of funds where about 750 crore plus funds is provisioned, where if you have a promising idea and product, let me tell you friends, finding a VC is not difficult these days. Some of our association that we have with fund of funds. And these are some of the areas. So for the numbers, we can have a look at this PPT later on. We have product showcases, like for example, last month we have product showcase with Australia. We have similar arrangements with other countries like Indonesia we had earlier. We try to look at niche market and not only look at focused markets, developed markets. We have industry challenges. Reverse pitching is there. Government as a marketplace, I already told you, for direct procurement. And these are some of the events that we conduct. And fund of fund is something that has created massive impact in my view. We have been able to bring the focus of this top-end funds to the startups in Kerala, which is more important. Well, otherwise, these funds are more happy to settle in Bangalore or Mumbai and not come to the next developing areas like Kochi. So we have been able to bring them here and expose them to our startups to see the uniqueness. And many of our startups have got benefited from them. So we have this government engagement that we are trying to strengthen. What is the government engagement we are trying to strengthen is one is direct procurement. And the second is limited tender. Among the startups, we try to do the tender. then exemption model startup are exempted from certain criteria about revenue and things like that. We have innovation zones inside the government departments like electricity board where this is done. Demand day is there where specific demands of health department or something are raised to startups. So far about 115 startups have been benefited, about 8.5 crores and 69 departments are active in this. And I feel we have been able to create a lot of impact. Like one case I generally give is about the Gen Robotics. As you know, friends, manual scavenging is a major issue. Even now in various parts of our country, it's actually extremely inhuman and below dignity of
it's human mute at 1 minute.
And in 2016, we tried to give a grant when we tried to, at MBS College in Kuttipuram, when we tried to form, when we had this innovative solution. Then through an idea grant, it developed the next stage. Then Honorable Chief Minister gave a grant in 2017 as part of KWA linkage. Then it went in a big way. Then Honorable Prime Minister launched it at national level in 2019 in presence of United Nations Secretary General. So this is what I would like to present. And thank you for your patient listening. I think my 40 minutes are almost coming to a close. So what I would like to conclude by saying to young friends is that it's an exciting time. All of you are entering the industry. You would have to ensure you have proper fundamental skills necessary in this era of digital transformation. And next two decades, India is going to develop in a tremendous rate. And all these startups, most of them backed with technology, try to solve at day-to-day issues of common people, of government, of businesses. So once we have this problem-solving attitude to look at how you have a problem, every day we see a lot of issues. When you come from your, let us say, day scholars, or when you come from your home to the institute, you see waste management issues, you see street light issue, water leakage issue, traffic issue. You can list, go on and on. So these are public policy problems I'm trying to throw at you. So how do we use technology? How do we use our critical thinking to solve these problems? Similarly, the problems in when you get into any business, you get into any company, if you get placed, that is something that you look in from a business perspective. And if you want to become entrepreneur, there is no better time and a situation than 2021. So that is what I like to present, and thank you all. And once again, like to thank SCMS for the opportunity. Any questions, I'd be happy to take. Thank you.
So, thank you for speaking about especially the startup landscape and unicorn landscapes, and also about the landscape recognition, and also educating us with the number of Kerala startups. Now, I would like to move on to the Q&A sessions, and I request Rahul to ask the questions.
Does the emergence of new technologies create new market niches for the development of innovative startups?
Emergence of new technologies. Having worked in IT sector for some time, let me tell you, technology is only the means to address a problem. It is not an end in itself. Okay. If you look at blockchain, for example, this is one of the emerging technology, right? Actually, emerging technology is not the right word, because decentralized ledger technology is almost 3 decades old, 30 years old. Blockchain attained prominence when these bitcoins were all coming in late 2007-8, So that is when it attained prominence. So first thing I would like to request you to understand is technology is a means to address a problem, not as a solution in itself. So therefore, when you have this new technology, the problem, the aspect to look at is how it will address our current problems. For example, talking on the same blockchain, right? Where can blockchain or decentralized ledger technology be used? One is, we go to a market, we find organic spices, okay? So on one side, we have normal spices, 100 rupees. Other side, you have organic spices, 500 rupees. So good, you are ready to pay. But the question you as a customer, we as a customer have is, how do you actually verify it is organic? It says it is Himalayan spice, for example. How do you
be sure it is somewhere grown in Himalayas or whatever. That is possible in blockchain when you look at source, when you look at verify the origin. So when we look at now, if we are trying to work on a project, this Nendram chips is all famous. It is common here, but we are trying to expand it through agriculture department is trying to do it, as a market, push it to London, a lot of demand. But the person there would obviously ask, how do you ensure it is actually Kerala chips, grown in Kerala, or, maybe it is just a spurious good. So that is where this technology would actually help. I can give examples in analytics front and so on. But to answer your question is, yes, technology gives opens up new avenues to solve existing problems. That is one. And technology also gives us opportunity to make life things better, to visualize how life can be better. Things, new opportunity, for example, analytics. This gives new insights into a business working, things which are not there. So two things: one, solve the existing problem, and second, look at the new emerging growth areas. So these are the areas where things should actually add up. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So in which fields of business are the largest startups of enterprises from SME sector?
SME sector, if you look at, we call MSME sector, micro, small, and medium enterprises. This is the official definition. SME is a more informal definition. If you look at where are the innovations which are developing, I would say mostly in fintech area, and even in manufacturing, supply chain, logistics area, it is getting developed.
Thank you, sir.
Rahul, I have one question, sir. Earlier studies on startups world over, it said like 80% of the startups end up as end-ups and they fail to take it to the logical end. So now it has changed, but still, where the major hiccups come? So you explain the entire process starting with the ideation, innovation till the logical end. Now, is it at the stage of funding or like the scaling up stage, or where do most of the failures happen? In which stage?
It's a good question. Actually, if you look at success rate of, I had, posted a very rosy picture, So all of you may think for a moment, I'll go and start a startup, So the fact is actually less than 10% of startups succeed. This is a fact. If you look at Silicon Valley per se, one research I saw recently in Stanford and a business review was only 6-7% actually succeed. And succeed is actually to survive for 3 years. It is not that they have become unicorns or something. So therefore, I won't say that is bad, because any solution which doesn't, is not a solution, per se, it is not valuable, right? So it is not required also that every startup should succeed. And our startup success in Kerala is between 20-25%. Okay. And in fact, sometimes I have asked my team also, isn't it a higher success rate? Because we don't want a mediocre solution to stay longer and actually fail at a later stage, because it's actually an injustice. Maybe at an we have a project, fail fast or succeed. So I feel to fail fast is very important in startup. Because maybe you will start up in the second way, you will come up with a different idea, the same blockchain you will put up and say, why? Blockchain is used in stock exchange, right? So you fail in this agriculture. Oh, Nendran chips, yaar London la medikum, but I will make blockchain enabled verification in Australian stock exchange. It's done. Or London stock exchange, why you should sell Nendran chips in London market? You can do it in London stock exchange, you can do blockchain. So the same concept, Hyperledger, right? So that is the chances of success is more. So failing fast is very critical also in startup. So to answer your question, specific question, Professor, I find two areas where startups fail. One is, technocrats, I was a technocrat long time back. Technocrats have a limitation that they get enamored with the technology innovation, they find that once they come into the technological innovation, they feel that that is very critical. But actually, what is critical is how the technology innovation solves the problem. Right. So, for example, as I said, the decentralized ledger technology was started in 1990s. No one knew that, but people who had actually learned computer science engineering in 1990s may have actually learned DLT. Only when cryptocurrencies came in 2006-07, and suddenly people found, okay, we can become billionaires in 2 days. Then they felt, yes, blockchain, DLT, everything became prominent. So otherwise, it was all lying just like that. So the first area where people fail is looking at technology as an end in itself. It is not an end in itself. It is a problem which is the end. You have to solve the problem with the technology. That is one. Second, I find where we fail many often is, unfortunately, it can solve a problem also, but the marketing is actually weak. Okay. I find that we as a country also, if you look at IT services, has grown big, but products have not really grown big. So even now, we are producing huge, lot of services. I also worked in two companies. Services is big time. We have a lot of innovators. We have a lot of, people who are problem solvers. But how do we actually brand it, convert it into a product, and make it a saleable commodity? Like, for example, SAP, how Germans did it. BMW, how that is being done, Apo our branding process, which requires very good marketing focus and creating a niche, targeting the customers, the four piece of marketing, all of you would be learning about the positioning, who is my customer, I'll target that. That becomes, I would say, Atkins Hill also. So two answers to two problems, I would say, is one is looking at, unfortunately, technology as an end in itself, which is definitely going to be a failure. If technology is not an end, it's a means, always a means to a problem solution. Second is marketing, which needs, I find, to be a focus. And try to build a brand, a product, which can actually, sell. That is what I would like to say. Do you know that, in fact, the telephones that we use still pays royalty to Finland? This ITIL and all, because there are certain royalties which had to be paid for 30 years. Even now, if you buy a landline, that is, I'm talking about landline, we still pay a royalty. And those people, Finland is now calling IT engineers. 5 lakh people they need, I heard. And we are paying a royalty just for using this, this manufacturing this. So that is the perspective I think we as a, it's a societal thing also, we have to change. We change over a period of time.
Yeah, that's true, sir. I think again in rural areas there is not much awareness. So whatever happens in rural areas by invented by rural people, based out of like indigenous indigenous developments, and also what you call the jugaad. So they don't get marketed at all because they do not have the professional knowledge of like selling their idea, making it, marketing it. So do you have any attempt to like reach out to the rural population in terms of developing startups?
Yeah. In Kerala, actually, as you see, the approach has been, to spread across. So the idea, Professor, is like my personal view is we have to tap talent from all segments, but ecosystem has to be centralized in a few areas, So a person in the most remote part of India should have access to all the schemes, all the, all the projects. He or she should be having access to the high quality education. But it doesn't mean that industry will go and establish in the remote corner. It doesn't work that way. Industry would be centralized in 10-15 cities in our country. That is how industries across the ages have developed, because once you scale up, you try to look at 2-3 major things. One is economics of scale come up if it's a manufacturing or something. So you have access to raw materials, which you call factors of production. And in startups or in technology, the main factor is actually resource, right? You need quality people. Actually, you don't believe we don't have quality software engineers in the state right now. The biggest problem of, let us say, Trivandrum is I keep hearing from CEOs, sufficient quality people are not there. So once I was in a conference, people are not getting jobs. Okay, so I challenged them openly. Give me 10 people who got certification in Java who are jobless. Oh, they were not able to give me 3 in city of Trivandrum. So I can tell you, friends, that if you are qualified, if you have good certifications from standard institutes, if you have the talent, getting a job in India is not difficult at all. You can sit on many jobs, particularly if you are in technology area. Okay. But sustaining it's in a different story. Getting a job is only one part of it. Sustaining is a different story, which I'm sure your staff would explain in detail. I would be exceeding my brief if I get into that. So to answer your question, sir, I feel the access, the reach, the quality of education which any person in the remotest part of India should be having should be there everywhere. That is what actually Thomas Friedman says in his book, The World is Flat, which was written 30 years back, right?
Yes.
World is flat. We know world is not flat, but it is flat because of access to these resources. So someone sitting on Himalayas would have same access like someone sitting on in San Francisco, you know, access to resources because of internet. He was talking about internet that time. But actually, you cannot develop a startup in the Himalayas. You have to come back to Bangalore or Kochi or somewhere because you need the ecosystem. You need hardware. You need products. You need access to VCs and things. So that's what we are trying to do. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So what are the sources of external financing used by innovative startups?
External financing, if you talk about foreign financing or VCs, venture capitalists. If you're talking about venture capitalists, see, you have two routes broadly. One is debt. You can borrow and then repay. Let us say you are opening a startup, you need 10 crores. You can take it as a debt and then repay. Okay. Or you can take it as an equity. Many VCs will come as an equity, but equity, you have to sell your stake in your company. Okay. Once you start selling the stake, obviously they are the owners. So they start dictating. So many actually startups don't like that equity route. Okay. But then when you actually want to expand big time, equity is something that you need to go with. So there is a I would say a balance, and you may have heard about in your finance, debt equity ratio should be what, 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, startups, various theories for it. We'll not get into that debt leverage, financial leverage aspects. But the point is, it should be a judicious balance. Many people, owners, feel that they want to retain the entire stake. They will not go to the equity route. They will only go for the debt, right? But debt is also costly. You cannot get cheap debts, right? You want to take 10 crore, they would have to pay a huge interest rate. So equity would come, but you will lose your ownership. So it is a decision which this startup owners have to make. And our role is to tell them about the entire spectrum. And it is they, as product owners, as CEOs, they have to make a choice. We don't push our decision on them. It is their product. We support that. And it is their decision.
Thank you, sir.
Some people also sell their stake and go. That is their choice. They go into, they have 2-3 startups, so they want to sell stake in one, take that investment and put it in them. So it's a business decision at a later stage.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir, for answering the questions. Now
Rahul, you are sitting in a lone man sitting in a class. What happened?
Yes, sir, we are sitting in a class.
We're in the campus, sir.
Acha. Only you are there.
No, sir. Our seniors are
there. Others are also there. Acha. Okay. I'm just kidding. Well, I think we can conclude. Taken a lot of your time, I hope. It's for you.
Yes, Catherine.
Yes. So I request, we have posted the feedback form. So I request all the students to kindly fill the feedback forms. And I would like to invite Dr. Anil Kumar, sir, chairperson PGDM, to propose a word of thanks.
Thank you, Catherine. So we are coming to the end of the program. Sir explained, actually, I think it was like a class. I think you need to be recording it and keeping it, because he started with the vast expansive geographical distribution and the spread of startups in India, talking about its presence in different sectors. He talked about the job it has created, around 6 lakhs also, and also he talked about the women directors' presence, though it is very low and a lot need to be desired. Participation of women is just 23%, sir explained that also. And also you talked about the unicorns, there are 63 unicorns and its total valuation made. And then sir went on explaining the structure of the innovative startups. Then how do we make the international connect, also the bridging with the international agencies. Then he explained the Kerala startup ecosystem, its specialities, starting with the shareholders, the ways of funding, the process of like getting like angel funding, and also you talked about, and how do we take it to the logical end of like after 3 years, it has to be a successful business. So you talked about that, and also the efforts taken by the department, and also in the form of educating the public and the students and the potential entrepreneurs, like efforts through IEDC, Fab Lab Academy programs, innovation zones, creating innovation zones, and specialized incubators. And also the kind of grants given by the government and early stage funding and how to scale up the business and the kind of government engagement and what are the facilities available. So he talked about the impact of intervention, and also I think it was a real motivation for the all the youngsters to come up with, to think about the general problems faced by the community and society, identify it, and then finding out possible solutions for that through innovative thinking. So it is very, very enriching, very informative, and I think all students enjoyed it, and they will definitely be using the recorded class because it's everything is there in your talk to know about the startup ecosystem. So thank you, sir, on behalf of the ACMS group of institutions, especially the School of Business of Cochin School of Business of ACMS, its board, faculty members, and students. I extend my sincere gratitude to you, sir. We also have Vice Chairman of the Board, Professor Pramod B. Thevanur, the Group Directors, Dr. Indu Nair, Dr. Baiju Radhakrishnan. So we're all behind, like bringing you here on campus, though online. So definitely when it is offline, sir, we started yesterday offline classes, we reopened the campus. So whenever you are here in Cochin, you are most welcome. So I express my sincere gratitude to all the group directors. And also my thanks are due to all the faculty, my faculty colleagues, and also the students of PGDM. So we had the PGDM batch 30 students attending the program, and also the faculty coordinator, Dr. Meera, and also the PGDM batch 29 student coordinators, Catherine, Ajit Janathanan, and Rahul. Thanks for everyone for coming over and then attending this program. So we have one more session coming up in the afternoon. And so please wait for that. So once again, Safirullah sir, so thanks for coming over and giving this beautiful address. So most welcome once again, sir. Whenever there is a time, please come over and talk. We have, as Indu ma'am said, we have started a new specialization course. And whenever you get time, so please come over and address the students. Not online, sir, but offline whenever you get time. So thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Indu ma'am, Pramod, sir, anything to...
Yes, no, thank you, sir. We'll get in touch with, sir. Thank you so much.
Before signing off, I would request everybody to kindly turn on your camera so that we can take a screenshot. Rahul? Okay, thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
As Anilkar sir has already mentioned, we have a session at 3 p.m., so kindly join. Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you all.